Good morning. I'm talking from the back right now, but I just wanted to make an announcement. Everybody's looking at the front. Where is he? Where is he? Our worship leader, Tim, and his wife, Pam, have been exposed to COVID. They've not been tested or tested positive, but because of their exposure, they are voluntarily self-quarantining. And so they will not be with us today. But due to the technology we have, we are able to have worship being led by them, the whole worship team. Even though you can't see them, you can hear them, and you can follow along in worship. So we invite you to do that. Let's bow for prayer as we begin the service this morning. Father God in heaven, we thank you today for who you are. We thank you that you make it possible for us to come to a place like this and worship you. We thank you for our technology that you have enabled people to develop and for the ability we have here in this church to continue to function the best we can. And so, Father, today as we worship you, we pray that you would help us to just connect with you in this time together. Be with Pam and Tim especially, that they would not develop symptoms or have the virus, Lord, and we just commit that to you right now as well. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Jesus, Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Sing with us. You are my strength.
Yeah.
people need the Lord. And that's why we exist, isn't it? That's why the church is here. The Church of Jesus Christ was commissioned to reach the world for him. That's why we exist. Today we come together in our corporate manner to worship the Lord. Some are worshiping by the internet and our live stream, and we welcome everyone together this morning because of the same Spirit everywhere. I feel like I've got my back to people over this side of the church, so just I'll try to remember to keep looking over there. I'm thankful to God for some improvement I'm feeling in my situation here. Maybe another week or so, I'm going to be back to normal, Lord willing. It's great improvement over this weekend, so looking forward to that. It's been a crazy couple of weeks for us, and thank you for your prayers and for your concerns and all that as well. As we go to prayer this morning, we just want to pray for our people, pray for the needs, and there are many. Mary Beth is home from the hospital, and they have physical therapy at home, and cannot put any weight on her foot yet, and so just continue to pray for Mary. It's going to be a long, long recovery for her. As you know, there's a fracture in her femur after her surgery. They had to do another surgery and fix that with rosin plates and screws and all that hardware, and so she's recovering from that now. And also Marilyn Johnson's brother passed away overnight Friday night, and so it was kind of a surprise, not expected. So we want to remember Marilyn and her family for the need that they have bereavement today. And we want to continue to pray for all of those who are affected some way by the COVID-19. As we mentioned this morning, Tim and Pam are exposed, and others have been exposed, others have been tested, others come back negative. We're glad that Shirley McLean's back to work. She got released to go back to work after her exposure, or she has tested positive, now she's okay. Dennis was a concern. He was tested and came back negative. So the guy is at work, and we continue to ask him to just watch over all of us, all of you. You who are here today, we just pray that God protects you. And especially those of you who are in that most vulnerable stage, and I'm not going to say you're old, I'm just saying you're in the most vulnerable stage, you know. So we want to pray for all of us. Amen? Let's join together in prayer right now. Father, what a privilege it is to come before you. We bow in your presence this morning. We are so grateful that you hear us. You never, ever get tired of hearing from us. We don't bother you. We are not pests. You invite us to come to you and bring you our needs and our concerns, and you also want to hear us say how much we love you, how wonderful you are. Your attributes are so great. And so today we just want to thank you for this privilege we have to pray. Lord, you know all of our needs. You know them better than ourselves. You know the outcome already. That's the thing that is so mind-boggling, is even as we pray to you today, we pray for our outcome, our desires, we realize that we don't have the ability to know the future, but you already know the outcome. You know how everything is going to work out. And so we just commit it to you today. Commit these requests, Father. Continue to pray for those who are affected by COVID, and we pray, Lord, that with the science that's been being applied, and with all the other things being taken by our leadership, we pray that we will see the end of this in the near future. We pray, Lord, that you would help us to be faithful in taking precautions, that you would just help us to not do anything that would harm anyone else. We pray for the people of our church. We pray for those gathered here today who are at risk, and we pray, Father, that you would just protect us. This is our prayer, that you would protect everyone here, not only while they're here, but when they go home and wherever they go, Lord, we pray for your protection over them. We pray for those who are at home because of their condition, because of being exposed or being testing positive, Lord. We pray for their recovery. We pray, Father, that you would just be with each and every one, wherever they are in this process. We pray, Lord, that you would be with Mary Beth today, that you would just continue to help her as she recovers and as she does therapy, and we know it's painful. We know that she's going through a lot of struggling there right now, and we just commit her to you. There's a couple that's very faithful in their attendance at church, but Lord, we pray that right now they can't be here, that you would just minister to them in their home where they are. We also pray, Father, for Gary Arnold. Continue to be with him today. We pray for Marilyn Johnston, Lord, in this sudden loss of her brother, Lord. We pray that you would protect her mind, Lord, to give her comfort. Help her, Lord, to just know that you're with her, and we ask for the comfort that would help her to just, her and her family, that they all be comforted today. We do pray, Father, for those who serve you around the world. We pray, Lord, for our missionaries. Continue to pray for Steve Vogt as he recovers from his heart attack this past summer, Lord, and we pray that you would continue to be with all of them who are serving in the national fields. We pray for our pastors and congregations in all these countries. We pray for those who are being persecuted today for their faith, Lord, and we just ask you to be with these countries. We sometimes find it difficult to remember them, because they're so distant from us. We don't know them. We don't even know these countries very well. We see names of countries and we have to look them up to find out where they are. But Lord, we know that right there in these countries, right now, there are people who are literally being persecuted. They're suffering because they want to do what we're doing right now, we take for granted. So we pray for them today. We pray for protection, we pray for encouragement, we pray for their faith. We pray for the leaders of those countries, Lord, that you would speak into their lives. Lord, we know that we're really fighting not against flesh and blood, but against the spiritual forces in high places. And so we pray for those who oppose Christ and oppose Christianity. And we pray for them today. Lord, we pray for our nation. We've been through a terrible week. Lord, words cannot even express what has happened and how that's affecting our country. Lord, we pray today that you would just be with those in leadership today. We pray for those in authority over us. Lord, we pray that you would, from the top of government, from the President of the United States, down to each and every one of us who say things and do things and post things that could be very inflammatory. We pray, Lord, that as a country, we could step back and say, look, we just need to be take a deep breath and not have this radical stuff going on that is endangering lives and really endangering freedom. Father, you know, again, the outcome of all this. You know how it's all going to turn out. And we pray today that as your people, as Christians, as Christ followers, we would follow you and not a political party. We would follow you and not an ideology. We'd follow you and not our government. Because we want you to have your way, to do your will in the world, in our country, and in our lives, in our lives. We want you to speak into us, to to do the right things. Father, we pray for our armed forces, wherever they are today. We pray that you protect them. And Lord, we just ask you for your blessing on America. We pray, Lord, that you would bless us today. We do many things that don't deserve the blessing. But even as individuals, we've done many things that never deserved Jesus go to the cross. But because he did, we have eternal life. Because of God's blessing, we enjoy what we do in our country today, where other Christians around the world don't have the freedoms we have. Thank you, Lord, for meeting with us again today. Praise your name. Glorify yourself. May everything said and done today be done to your glory. We ask in Jesus' name. What kind of relationship do you want to have with God? Think about that for a moment, would you? What kind of relationship do you want to have with God? Do you want a casual acquaintance? Or do you want an intimate interaction with him? You know, Jesus said something in the New Testament. He said that I call you friends. I call you friends. And there's a danger that we become maybe too casual with God, where we call Jesus our buddy. He is a friend, but I tell you today, he's much more than that. He's my Savior. He went to the cross and died for me. He's my Lord. He is coming back, and I'll stand before him someday, give an account of my life. That sounds a little bit more than just a casual friend, doesn't it? But God loved us so much that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. He loved us that much, and he desires to have an intimate relationship with us. We want to talk about this morning. But in talking about that, we want to emphasize that we have a choice. We can have a God that is kind of like out there when we need him, that he's kind of an acquaintance. I know God, and I'm a Christian, and I go to church. We can talk about that kind of stuff, but we also can say, I want to get as close to Jesus as I possibly can. I want to have that relationship with him that I have with my best friend. That he's there, and I not only receive something from that relationship, but I give to that relationship. You know, a good friend doesn't just take. If you've got a friend as a taker, you soon get tired of that. But when you have a friend where there's give and take, and you're a giver as well as a taker in that relationship, it makes a world of all difference. Being a Christ follower takes time, effort, and discipline. I want you to underscore that in your mind. To be a Christ follower, not just a churchgoer, not just a Christian because I'm not a Buddhist. You know, sometimes I'm Christian because I'm not Hindu, I'm Christian because, you know. No, to be a Christ follower, to follow Jesus Christ, it takes time, it takes effort, and it takes discipline. There's a verse in Scripture that we're not using as our text today. It's kind of like a theme verse. I may use this for the next several weeks. John chapter 10, verse 10, it says, the thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. That's what Jesus said. That's what the thief does. He says, I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. Experiencing the abundant life results from opening up ourselves to the full relationship that Christ extends to us by grace. This relationship is enhanced through the practice of spiritual disciplines. Anyone who improves themselves knows that in order to do that, there are disciplines you have to go through. If you want to get those six-pack abs, there's a discipline, isn't there? There's discipline about what you eat, there's discipline about how you work out, there's discipline about how what you do, and it doesn't happen overnight, by any means. If you want to be financially secure, you could be disciplined. You can't spend just because it's there to spend, and you can't have everything you want right now because you know it takes discipline to get to the place where you are financially independent. As we begin this new year, 2021, we are going to look at five of these spiritual disciplines over these next weeks. Do this in order to discover, remember last week we talked about discover? Discover how they impact the abundant life as a follower of Jesus Christ. These five disciplines are prayer, which we're going to talk about today, Bible reading, service, relationships with each other, and giving. All of these things are disciplines. They're spiritual disciplines. They're things we work on as spiritual followers of Jesus Christ. Today we look at how prayer enhances our intimacy with God. How does prayer enhance our intimacy with God? How does prayer help us get from God being a casual acquaintance to being that close, dear friend in that relationship? Three scriptures we'll refer to this morning. First comes from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verse 42, which is a familiar one. I know that probably everybody here has heard it before. It talks about the early church where it says they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. They devoted themselves. They devoted themselves to prayer. Philippians chapter 4 and verse 6. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And then again, 1 Thessalonians 5:17. This verse is real short. You want to memorize a verse? Memorize this one and go home and say, look, I memorized a Bible verse this morning. 1 Thessalonians 5:17 says, pray continually. Pray continually. Yeah, I know the other version says pray without ceasing. A little bit longer. Pray continually. Prayer enhances our intimacy when we make it a priority. I do nothing in my life that I have not made it as a priority, either consciously or subconsciously. There are things we do because it's important to us. We have a certain TV program we want to watch every day. We make sure we're there to watch it because it's a priority. We have meal times that we choose to eat because it's a priority to us. Things are a priority when they are important to us. prayer doesn't always make it to the top of the list, does it? I'm not saying this to be judgmental. I say it because we all are human beings, and that happens. We, in our humanity, in our carnal existence, prayer sometimes gets relegated to the bottom of the list. Sometimes we go to bed at night and think, I've got to say my prayers. Or we get up in the morning and we take off and do our routine, but I hadn't stopped to pray. Someone has said, you know, in response to people say, I'll have time to pray. I've heard it said by several, you don't have time not to pray. Because prayer is that important. And yet we all are guilty of not making it a priority. God desires more than a casual relationship with us. God desires much more than just to be casual. He wants that friendship. He wants that interaction. He wants that intimacy. The early church, as we mentioned in that Acts chapter 2, verse, the early church was devoted to prayer. You see, prayer was not optional for them. As I was thinking about this week, I was thinking about what it would have been like to be among them that were in the upper room, experienced the coming of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. Those who experienced that also experienced watching Jesus die on the cross. They experienced the discovery of the empty tomb. Many of them saw Jesus rise on the day of ascension and go into heaven. They had all of this going on, and they now are without Christ in a physical way. And they become a church. They become the church. And they are devoted to prayer. I think about that, I think probably because of their experience. Probably because of what they've not only experienced and the things I just mentioned, but also in the fact that they were still being persecuted. A few chapters later in Acts, the persecution got really, really bad. They were dispersed from Jerusalem, but they were still not the popular ones. They were not getting all the breaks in life. The leadership, the Roman leaders did not respect them, and even the Jewish leaders did not respect them. And so they had things going on in their lives to where the point I'd say that they I'm pretty sure that prayer was not an option. It was something that they had to do because they had to connect. They did not forget to pray. They depended on prayer to maintain a relationship with the Lord. They didn't depend upon Christian radio or television or music or friends or even the church fellowships like we have. They had a relationship with the Lord, and to maintain that relationship, they had to pray. Prayer was a vital part of their daily lives. I don't see in the early church where there were rigid requirements to be fulfilled to pray. When prayer becomes ritualistic, I think it becomes less effective. They did go to the temple at appointed times. It tells us that, you know, in the book of Acts, at the time of prayer, they went to the temple. And I think that can coincide with, like, you and I. We came to church this morning at the appointed time. We didn't come at 7 o'clock this morning because we knew it wasn't time yet. We don't come at 3 o'clock this afternoon because we know it's too late to come. We came at the appointed time to be together. So that's what they did. And yet, I don't see in Scripture where the Christian church, the early church, paused at 10 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 6 o'clock, and 9 o'clock at night, stop what they were doing to pray, as there are some who do today in some religions. I don't see that that's how it happened.
The prayer was an appropriate response to what God had done and was continuing to do. They had that intimate communication, that connection with Jesus. I think about, you know, is it easier to write a letter to somebody that you had talked to 6 months ago and you've related to and a friend of yours and they moved away? Well, you can write a letter and you write. It's supposed to tell them. And then we can say, well, write a letter to this person you never met. What do I tell them? What do I say? These people who are praying most likely had interacted with Jesus. They had that relationship. And God was continuing to do things in their lives, in the church, through prayer. The early Christians understood that prayer provided for a personal relationship with God. How do you have a personal relationship with anybody if you don't communicate? Prayer nurtures this relationship. If you never talk to somebody, that relationship does not get nurtured. In marriage, they say the two biggest things that are causes for marital breakdown are issues to deal with finance and communication. How many of us live in homes where when you go home today and go to your house, you and your wife or you and your husband will not talk at all until next Sunday? Wouldn't go very well, would it? And even when you're upset with each other, I won't say mad, but when you're upset with each other, when you have those disagreements and you don't talk for a while, it's miserable, isn't it? Because you have to interact with each other. That personal relationship is something that is nurtured through prayer. It is the primary way we interact with God is through prayer. Prayer allows us to speak to God and hear His voice. Now, understand, there's two things, there's two parts of prayer. Prayer is not us doing all the talking. Prayer is us also doing some listening. It's two-way communication. There are times we need to just be still and know that He is God. We need to stop and let Him speak into our lives. Yes, He wants to hear us, but He also wants to talk to us. And that leads us to the next part of prayer. And prayer enhances our intimacy when we make requests to Him. Philippians 4:6 says, present your requests to God. You know, being a parent, there's probably nothing, well, a lot of things probably, you know, but there's something special about when your child comes to you and says, can you do me a favor, or would you do this for me? Could I have this? Not the demands, not the gimme, gimme, gimme part of the story, but when children say to their parents, and even teenagers and adult children who come to the parent and ask for some favor, it makes you feel good. It makes you feel good, doesn't it? You feel like, wow, they really have that relationship. They're free to come and ask. Even if a child got into financial difficulty, and it was very difficult for them. They aren't the basement dwellers who are living off of their parents. But I'm talking about people who have tried, fallen on hard times, and come back and say, I hate to do this, but can you help me out? Who of us would not give a gift to our child who genuinely needed it? Jesus talked about that. The Father gives good gifts to the children. He wants us to ask, and he never gets tired of hearing from us. Please understand something. God is not interrupted when we call him. There is never a busy signal when we call him. He doesn't hit the mute button. He doesn't say, oh, here she comes again, or here he is again. Oh dear, you know. Now, humanly speaking, you and I sometimes do that, don't we? Oh, they're calling again. Or that person is cough, 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 cough. No, God never gets tired of hearing from us. In fact, he has multiple lines. He's no busy people. He can hear from all of us at one time, all of us at the same time. He wants to pour out his blessings upon us. The one thing about God is he desires to be intimately involved in our lives. He doesn't want to be on the sidelines. He doesn't want to be left out of the loop. He doesn't want to be somebody who we just take off the shelf once in a while. He wants to be intimately involved in our lives. He wants to help us to overcome the problems we face. Nothing pleases him more than to help us be overcomers, to deliver us from something. You say, well, I'm going through something, or I have an addiction or something in my life that I just can't get past that. I need delivered from this. Nobody can do that. God can do that. God wants to do that. Because God, he wants to comfort us. He understands when we go through bereavement and grief. He wants to comfort us. He wants to heal our infirmities. He wants to hear from us. What's on your mind? What's going on? What do you need from me? God asks. He wants to hear from us. And he brings peace to our lives. He brings peace. Let me remind you of what Paul wrote to the Philippians in chapter 4, verse 7. The next verse, I talked about verse 6 here, but the very next verse, it says, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, or transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. First of all, we make our request known to him by prayer and petition with thanksgiving. We share our concerns and our needs. And then, immediately following that, we're told the peace of God, which transcends all of our understanding, we can't comprehend it, will guard your heart and guard your mind in Christ Jesus. God wants us to bring our concerns to him. It says in Philippians 4, do not be anxious about anything. Let's talk about that for a moment. Do not be anxious about anything. In Matthew chapter 6, in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said this, therefore, do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For after all these things, the Gentiles seek. Don't be like them. Don't worry about these things. For after all these things, the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. He already knows. He knows we need them. But Jesus said, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. Worry. Get this. Worry is not a sign of strength. Worry is not an indication that you've got control. Worry is not a sign that you've got it all together, that you are independent, that you are self-sufficient. Worry does not convey that. Worry is not a sign of strength. Really, it's probably a sign of weakness. But it is also a call for prayer. When we are tempted to be anxious about things, it's not a time to wring our hands and worry about it. It's a time to go to God in prayer. He wants us to make requests. It becomes an intimate relationship when we make our requests. And then the third thing we see here is that it enhances our intimacy when we make it second nature. When prayer becomes second nature to us, second nature prayer is living in the presence of God and acknowledging that presence. When are you not in the presence of God? Christ follower? When are you and I not in the presence of God? Let me answer that question. Never. Never. The Holy Spirit indwells every follower of Christ. You are a believer, the Holy Spirit is so near to you, He is as close to you as breath itself. When you breathe in and you breathe out, that air has got to kind of interact with the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is right here inside of us. We have to live with that awareness. And as followers of Christ, second nature prayer is living in that presence. It's not sporadic or by chance. Rather, it is an integral part of our spiritual journey. It's not optional. We mentioned that already. It's something that is a integral part of our walk with Christ. It's not limited to place or ritual. As we talk about the book of Acts, yes, there are times they went to the place of prayer and they prayed. There's a place of prayer. There's a corporate prayer. There's a time that we as a church ought to come together and pray. We need to do more of that, where we can come together, and post-COVID, maybe we can maybe pick up on that a little bit more and get together more for prayer. Pray together. Intimate prayer is not reciting ritual prayers. Now, hear me out here. Please be careful. I'll be careful. I don't want to say anything that is misleading. There are classic prayers that we can read from some of the spiritual giants. And they can be inspirational. They can even teach us a bit about praying. But they are not a substitute for relational intimacy. It's like quoting poets to communicate with our love for our spouse. Do you love me? How do I love thee? Let me count the ways. Just tell me. Don't give me some poet. Just give me. Tell me. Tell me from your heart that you love me. Childhood prayers are great because they help to teach prayer to children. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. I learned that one. I've always looked back on that as an adult and wondered why that prayer says, if I should die before I awake. That was scary for a child, doesn't it? I'm going to sleep. If I die while I'm in bed, But that's how it goes. If I should die before I awake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. And then I was taught to add, God bless mommy, daddy, grandpa, grandpa, and everybody else. But I passed that. When I go to bed now, I don't lie in bed or kneel by my bed or whatever posture one takes and say, now I lay me down to sleep. I come from a whole different perspective because I've grown past the childhood prayers. Disciples even ask Jesus, teach us to pray. And the Lord's Prayer that we have, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. And going through that prayer was a model prayer. Jesus said, pray like this. And it's okay to pray that prayer. It's okay to pray the Lord's Prayer. There's nothing wrong with that. Many people do that as part of their worship. When I was young, we went through school, elementary school, praying that every day in school until the atheists took it out of, made it unconstitutional. But if that's the only prayer we pray, it was not designed to be the only prayer you pray. It was designed to be a model prayer. Pray like this. Pray that we worship and hallow the name of Father God. Pray for his will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. Pray give us our daily bread, and so forth and so forth. Prayer. Prayer is a conversation with God. Prayer is an opportunity for us to have an honest conversation with our Father God, where we articulate our struggles and we articulate our gratitude to Him as well. Intimate prayer takes place anywhere. I skipped the line, I'm sorry. Intimate prayer takes place anywhere. Its form can be silence, just listening. Its form can be brief utterances. When something is happening right now, urgently, we don't stop and say all the ritual stuff, oh, our Father in heaven, we beseech you today. We usually say, God, help me. That's what is the urgent thing, right? We cut past all our stuff. So prayer can be a long engagement, or it can be brief utterances. I remember years ago, many years ago now, I was taking my newly betrothed fiance to meet my parents. And we were probably engaged for about 24 hours when this took place. On our way there, went down a hill. And the hill was steep, the hill was snow covered, the hill was slippery. The driver of the car was foolish. I didn't have all of the presence of mind to drive more carefully. I was excited to get to my mother's house, my father's house, to show off my new fiance. So I'm going down the hill, put on the brakes, and guess what? No traction. My little Chevy Chevette began to spin like this. And we saw chain link fence. Every time we spun around, we saw chain link fence. My newly betrothed fiance was in the passenger seat saying, dear Jesus, dear Jesus, dear Jesus, dear Jesus. The most effective prayer she could have prayed. She didn't get very articulate about how God was going to get us off that hill. She wasn't telling him to find traction on the road. He wasn't telling him to find the brake. You know, she was just saying, dear Jesus, dear Jesus, dear Jesus. got to the bottom of the hill, the car straightened out, we drove off, and I was a hero. I did good, didn't I? Yeah, right. And she still married me, even though I tried to kill her, you know, just, she just still married me. Prayer can be the extended dialogue. Prayer can be an hour long. Prayer can be when you're talking to God about things. And some of my best prayer times have been when I've been driving the car, eyes open, of course. But if I'm on a longer trip and I'm not, you know, like on a turnpike or an interstate, just talk to God. And I've done that, just conversation goes on and on and on and on. And I can remember, because of those times, I can remember things that came out of that to this day. Effective results because of that prayer. And so we share our struggles with Him as well as our gratitude. That's what we do in prayer. God, I'm going through this. I need this. Yes, yes, yes. But God, I'm also so thankful who You are. You are so wonderful to me. And we're able to seek His guidance or seek discernment. Last week we talked about that. That discernment is so important. We need to hear from God and give His direction in life. And so as we conclude this morning, it has been said that prayer changes things. You've heard that many, many times. You can buy that plaque in any mail order place. Now you can't go to Christian bookstores anymore, but you can find that maybe even at Walmart. You can buy a plaque that says prayer changes things. But the reality of that is prayer changes us. Prayer doesn't even change God, because God is unchangeable. God doesn't change. But when we pray, prayer changes us by opening up to us the discovery. Keep that word in mind. The discovery of the Holy Spirit leading our lives, enabling us to experience the abundant life that Jesus came to give us. Jesus said, I came that you might have life and have it more abundantly. To have it to the full extent. That's why I came. How do we get there? Prayer enhances our intimacy with God. And I invite you to pray. I encourage you to pray. I encourage prayer to become more of a priority in our lives. Your life, my life, we all need to improve, don't we? May this year, may 2021 be a year that we do pray more. Pray more effectively. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray. Father, You're good. You're good to us. You are one who really cares about everything about us. We thank You for that. And I pray for everyone in this room, everyone listening and watching by live stream or video. I pray, Father, that You would help us in this coming year, this year that we've now turned the calendar page, that we might enhance prayer, that we might make it more of a priority in our lives and be in a relationship with You that's much more than just a casual relationship. Thank You for Your presence here this morning. Thank You for the presence that doesn't leave us when we leave this place. That You're going to be with us as we walk out the door, down the ramp, we walk into the car, and we drive home, and we get to our homes, or get to a restaurant, or whatever we do today. We know that as we do these things, You're with us and will be with us 24/7, because that's what You promised to be. You will never leave us nor forsake us. Thank You for that. Go with us now as we leave this place, but not Your presence. In the name of Jesus, we pray these things and devote this to You this morning. Amen. God bless you. Good to be together once again.
And catch you next week, if not before. Amen.
Have a great week.